Hey, I'm Mynor with RPS Solar Pumps, and today I'm going to go over some troubleshooting tips for your wireless tank sensor units. So I have here in front of me two of our 24-hour wireless tank sensor units. Each of them has an identical setup with a battery hooked up on the back of a panel. We have the wireless unit itself, and then we have an antenna for each of them and a solar panel. And so what this will allow us to do is to have our receiver be hooked up to our controller, and then our transmitter is going to be hooked up on the other end on a tank with our tank flow. This will allow the units to talk to each other without having to trench hundreds and hundreds of feet. If you have a 110 or 220 AC model, you'll get a transmitter that is on a solar panel with a battery backup system, and your receiver side will be conveniently housed in this plastic box where you will have either 110 or 220 AC electricity running through it. So your units won't come with a buzzer and LED light, but for the purposes of this video, the buzzer turning on and the light turning on are going to signify a tank full status being shown by the transmitter and receiver, thus signaling your pump to stop. So now that the two units are paired, they're already communicating to each other and everything is turned on. Now let's say I take the pro float here and it starts to rise up in the tank as the water gets full. The tank float will go up. And after about a 6 to 7 second delay, we'll see that the two units are talking to each other, sending a tank full signal. And we can hear our buzzer going off and our little LED light is lit up. And so the tank full light is illuminated on both of these units currently. And then once the float goes back down, the water level in the tank starts to empty. You have your 6-7 second delay between the two units talking. The sound goes off. So when the sound is on and the LED is lit, that means that the two units are talking to each other and a tank full signal is being transmitted by the units, corresponding with the position of the pro float. Up for being tank full and down for being tank empty. The way that the antennas communicate with each other is through a wave from the antenna. Rather than have the wave go directly from the tip of the antenna out, it actually spreads out from this center piece, much like a donut hole. The wave will then start to spread out sideways and around it. You'll typically need to have a line of sight within the two units, and they need to be roughly on the same level field with each other. And so sometimes what happens is that there'll be a hill or a concrete building in the way that'll block the communication between the two units. So one common misconception there is that the antenna will actually communicate to each other better if they're pointed at each other. So what ends up happening is the two units will have their antennas pointed at each other, and the wave from each of the antenna will go outward like so, and then there's very little contact point between each other. So they need to be on the same level field. Whenever this happens, what we'll have to do is go through the repairing process, much like trying to repair your phone's Bluetooth back to your car. For this part, we'll need a Phillips head screwdriver to take off the faceplate of both units. And it is actually easier to repair the units when they are close to each other, but it can be done with a buddy and a walkie-talkie. Now that we have all the screws off, we can go ahead and take off the cover plates from both units. Now that I have both units covers off, we can begin the pairing process. It all starts with the receiver unit. What we're going to do is press and hold down the receiver unit button for about 30 seconds. After about 30 seconds, the power light will start flashing. Once the power light begins to rapidly blink, it signifies that the receiver unit is looking for another unit to pair with, essentially our transmitter. Once the receiver is rapidly blinking its power button, you will go over to the transmitter side and double press the button located inside to send the signal for pairing. Once the two units are paired with each other, there'll be a momentary stop of the lights flashing, and you should hear a click in the receiver end side. At that point, you can go ahead and test the units to make sure that they're paired by activating your float sensor. The tank full light should come on the transmitter side, followed shortly by the receiver side. If you have one of our RPS 200 to 800 models, you will take your two wires coming off of the receiver and wire them up into COM2 and TH. This is normally where you would wire up your tank full sensor. If you have one of our ProLine models, instead, what you'll need to do is take the two wires coming off the wireless receiver and wire them up to the COM port plug included in your Pro Kit. The COM port plug will be a black and blue pigtail that has two wires coming off of it to meet with these two wires coming off of your receiver. If you're not using one of our RPS controllers, you take the two wires coming off the receiver unit and wire them into the control box that receives the tank full sensor inputs normally. This will allow the receiver to communicate with your control box, thus shutting off your pump. In the case of the 110 and 240 AC models, you don't wire any sensors in on the receiver side. Instead, on the receiver side, you would wire in your source of 110 or 220 VAC power directly into this black contactor port. Another common question is, what can be wired into the transmitter? And so we have here our ProFloat already wired into our transmitter, but you can use a variety of different styles of floats. You can use pressure switches, you can use our RPS 200 to 800 tank full sensors, and other third-party tank full sensors in general, so long as they have a two-wire input. And this has been our wireless tank sensor troubleshooting video. For more solar-powered content, go ahead and hit that subscribe button and ring that notification bell.